gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
And so now it's been a month and a day that little LaMelo Parker has been killed. A month and a day. And within 24 hours, we see body cameras in Tallahassee. It's amazing. No body cameras whatsoever from any of the officers who were on duty that day when LaMelo was killed. All we have to go on, actually, is the video from passersby. And I understand from some of those, law enforcement have sought to get those videos. It's okay. I think that's reasonable. But it's just curious to me, Ro, as to how it is that here you have what seemingly is an open and shut case, if there is a case. You got a double homicide, as per the coroner. A video, more than likely body cam, an event that took over 2 hours, and 150 miles or so. Every agency that you can think of was involved, from Louisiana all the way to Biloxi.
Transparency of milk.
And we can't simply find out, and you can't confirm what happened to little LaMelo when close to 30 some odd shots were fired. You know what, even if you could clear up whether or not Smith, the father, lose that term loosely, even if you can clear that up as to whether he shot his own son, decided to drive to Biloxi, whether he even fired a shot at all, or whether it was a mistake. Don't be weenies about this. Don't be cowardly. Don't be cowardly. I mean, you know, let me just tell you this, folks. It really annoys me. It really annoys me when it makes us suspicious, we law-abiding citizens who believe that law enforcement is doing an excellent job. And we believe that. I believe that. I mean, we've not had the kind of carnage and the kind of suspicion that we've had here that we've had in other places. There's no doubt about that, folks. I have talked to just about every chief of police, sheriff, the public safety commissioner, even FBI. I mean, everyone here I've at some point or another had a conversation with, and maybe a few chiefs I've missed because they've changed a few of recent months. But we've not had that. For the most part, there's been some professionalism. I'm not going to speak for all officers and all encounters you've had with officers, but for the most part, there's been some desire, at least, to maintain professionalism. Now, why does this three, four-month-old child have to be treated differently? It causes suspicion. Now, no doubt, the Biloxi PD is doing the investigation. They're doing a thorough job. We reached out to them. And they basically said that they're trying to do the best they can. However, they have to depend on other agencies to forward whatever information they're requesting.
Yeah.
And I don't know whether those other agencies, in this case, it would be the state troopers, highway patrol, sheriff's department, and Gulfport PD, because those three agencies supposedly had shooters in it. I don't know whether they're moving expeditious to cooperate or not. I do know this, though. And I'm going to say this across the board here. Law enforcement, you guys, and I'm not talking about the rank and file. I'm not talking about the lowly little patrolman, because they're not controlling this. They're not controlling this narrative. I know that, guys. You guys who are traveling on the street, y'all not controlling this. I know it's the administrators. And in some cases, maybe even it becomes a little political. I know that. You know, the commander is the individual, and then ultimately the DA is those individuals who are going to decide what happens next. It's beyond their pay grade, bro. The shooters that was there are not deciding whether or not to come out and apologize for the death of LaMelo.
It's above them now.
But don't you think it's sad that no one has? Don't you think it's just sad?
Yeah. Not a good look.
You hear the baby scream after the shots and nobody come out with any kind of remorse, regret. You just pat each other on the back and say, good job. After you lowered your standards and fired upon a vehicle knowing there was a hostage in the car? I couldn't be that kind of cop. I'm just going to tell you this. I'd probably have to lose my job because I'd be damned if I'm going to lose my soul. If I was there that day, trust me on this, my belief in my Almighty would be far greater than my belief in my superiors. There's no CYE here. There's no CYE. There's no cover your rear end here. This is just purely being human. It's not even about being above the law. It's just being a decent human being, bro. Come on, what? When did you put on a badge and a uniform and decide that you don't have to be a decent human being? Or when did you decide that some people were humans and some were not? The only person who can think like that is a person who has absolutely, positively, not one shred of compassion in him at all. I don't want him near me. I don't even want him near you. So if you're one of those officers and you are aware, I want you to ask yourself, would it be too much to say, look, you know, I regret that happened. We apologize we got to that point. I don't mean you claim responsibility for shooting little LaMelo. It just simply means this baby's life was lost and nobody saying anything. I want you to listen to this officer in Tallahassee literally praying to himself on his body camera that he doesn't have to shoot this 14-year-old girl who has been shooting for hours. A shotgun. Then she got a long gun. And then she got a pistol. Shooting at officers after breaking into a house with her 12-year-old accomplice. Shooting out the back window. This guy hiding behind a tree. Didn't look like it's no more than about 16 inches wide. That wasn't very good cover, but still. He had a Glock. And obviously that place was surrounded. Maybe he had a, because I don't know if that was a helicopter or whether that was a drone that was taking the pictures there. You're familiar with the story, the 12 and 14-year-old who were orphaned and sent to live with someone else, and they escaped from there and then broke into a house, and that house had a whole bunch of guns, and those individuals should be held directly responsible. They should be held liable as far as I'm concerned. Not unless these kids broke into a safe. Even then, you still should be liable.
Really?
It's your gun. If they took his car and they went out and had a wreck, then guess what? The insurance company is going to be. It's a stolen car, but yet you do understand that your insurance company is still on the hook. We who are gun owners have to take that responsibility, whether we are there or not, whether it's stolen or not. We got to have that responsibility. It's in our name. Of course, there's no law that says that. That's just Rip Daniels. There should be a law as far as I'm concerned. Of course, that doesn't stop me, Rip Daniels, from having liability insurance inclusive of that. Just saying. Would you listen to this officer? Do you have a name for it? This is very good police work, by the way. I like good police work. And good police work, don't get it twisted. Good police work does not necessarily mean that that what you're doing that day results in no injuries or even no deaths. You can have deaths and it'd be still good police work. I'm not one of these conscientious objectors. I do understand that there is such a thing as self-defense. But there should be protocol as well. You can't just say, you know, I'm in fear of my life about everything and kill it. There's a possum. I'm in fear of my life. It could be a rabbit, raccoon. I'm in fear of my life. There was a guy, I heard him on Charlemagne this morning, who had an iguana, killed an iguana. Of course, I personally think that was animal abuse, but nevertheless, he tried to take the position where the iguana had bit him. Well, as it turns out, the video shows he jumped on the iguana first, 3 foot long iguana.
Definitely animal abuse.
But iguanas are some ugly rascals, though, I can tell you right now, you know. Some of the uglies in St. Thomas. They come near you, trust me on this. You really, it's not the kind of thing you want crawling up behind you.
Yeah, sure. I'll remind you that they're herbivores, though.
Well, right, they won't jump on you. Unless you've got a piece of celery. Won't you listen to this cop? Praying that he does not have to shoot this 14-year-old girl.
She's racked around the shotgun. The window is busted out on the patio side. So if she comes out, she's going to have the firearm.
Okay, well then you challenge her. But let's pull behind hard cover. And let's try to do everything you can to try to shoot her.
Juvenile male has a firearm in his hand. Juvenile female is at the 1-2 side corner. Not sure if they're going to come to the front door or not. Stand by. Don't make me do this. Don't do this.
Don't make me do this. Don't do this. Don't make me do this. Don't do this. He don't want to shoot that girl.
No.
She's already fired at him. I counted at least maybe 6 times over the times. What they did was, ladies and gentlemen, they spliced this. It's happened over several hours. And what it looks like is that, because it went from day to night, I mean, and very, very quickly. And as night fell, is when the officers ultimately ended up shooting the 14-year-old girl. But they were taking shots at him, bro.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Don't make me do this. Don't do this. And I want you to know, the commander was very, very forthright. He said, stand down, let's wait it out.
Yeah.
You have that?
Hear their orders.
Female has a shotgun in her hand. Stand by.
Put the gun down now!
That's them shooting.
Hey, guys, just hold behind hard cover. Let's not shoot these kids, man. Let's just hold it. Take our time.
10-4, they're shooting at me. Hold it. Hold the air. I'm code 4. She's re-racking around inside the shotgun.
All right, let's not engage them anymore. Let's not challenge them. Just hold behind hard cover. We're just going to hang out here. Unless they come out and they're going to be compliant, let's not go ahead and try to escalate this any further, guys. Everybody stand by.
Did you hear that? Did you hear that?
Yeah. Let's not try to escalate this any further.
Yeah.
Everybody stand by.
They're isolated. These two people isolated in the house. The kids. Houses surrounded, not going anywhere. Ladies and gentlemen, I understand, because I'm in the radio business, and really, it has helped me over these many, many years to really appreciate time. And what I mean by that is that we in this business operate under 60 seconds. You know, I can sit here and rumble off a commercial and just about hit 60 seconds. Roe has seen me do it many times, or 30 seconds. I just ramble it off. Sometimes I'll do an ad lib and it's a 60 second ad lib. I'm going somewhere with this. When you are able to control the time, typically, you can control the circumstances. Now, I'd like to say that, well, I learned that in radio, but I learned the opposite as a CMET finisher. You see, when you, my brothers there who in masonry, kudos to you. Of course, I know yesterday was a rain day, and now you got to pick up where you left off and hope it doesn't rain. When you're working in CMET finishing, ladies and gentlemen, or any other business that whereby you don't control the substance, you don't control the time that the substance gets hard, then you've got to tool it while it's pliable, while it's toolable. You got to go in and use your straight edge. You got to level that thing off. First and foremost, right? You've got to get it inside the forms, and concrete is not going to tell you when it's going to get hard. So it is in control of the time. Now, I have some folks who play some games or use a little sugar or put some more chemicals in it to try to keep it. I know, you know, it lessens the strength of the concrete if you're dealing with like 3,000 PSI or something like that. I know all that. Point is, though, and my daddy taught me this very well, the concrete boy ain't going to wait for you. You're not going to control the time. If you don't control the time, then the circumstances, ladies and gentlemen, the circumstances, it's not within your control. You know. In other words, if these two assailants, these kids were running down the street going somewhere, if they were not in a position whereby they were like sitting ducks, whereby you have now immobilized them, you are in control of their mobility. And they're right there. So now you can determine. You can determine at a time of your choosing when you take them or don't. And that's exactly what this commander was saying. Hey, well, just pull back. All right, just wait. Hey, they're shooting at me. He could have very easily said return fire. You do understand that these guys are probably far more trained than this 14-year-old and 12-year-old. And I don't doubt by this time they've got some pretty good scopes now, long guns, whereby if, in fact, they really wanted to, bullet right behind the ear. I don't doubt that. Because they had the advantage. I mean, and as night falls, you're able to see, periodically you're able to see lights come on and go off. And that's basically law enforcement. Don't ask me how I know this. Tactically, they're letting each one know where they are. Right? And in some cases, there were a dot or two that I could see. Little orange one, little green one. So they had control of the time, bro. That's why the commander said that. We have control of the time. Ladies and gentlemen, LaMelo and his daddy, use that term loosely, were sitting in the median of I-10. Four flat tires stuck in the mud, a deputy's car behind them, a state trooper's car in front of them, boxed in. Who controlled the time? You control the time, you control the consequences, and the consequences went very, very wrong. And I want to know how, I want to know why. I want to know that. And no, I'm not letting it go. And I want to know why no one has come forward to say, you know what? That baby didn't deserve this. I'm sorry it happened that way. Someone besides Rip Daniels, I wasn't there, but it breaks my heart. It breaks my heart. So in this case, with the officer, so now the girl is in critical condition.
The girl is now being held in secure detention. I think she's been upgraded to stable.
Well, they're felony now. If you've got their names and all, I'm not going to give it to them.
Right. She's going to be held in secure detention for 21 days. The boy made his first court appearance yesterday. A judge ordered him to be held after finding probable cause on charges, including attempted murder of law enforcement officer. Both are accused of shooting at the deputies there for hours.
So she indicated she wanted to roll. What was that all about? I understand that's from a video game.
I'm not.
You're going to roll on them or something like that?
Yeah, unless it's like a GTA reference or something.
They said it actually came off of the that video game that you used to play sometime. That
Grand Theft Auto. I still play it, but. It can mean a couple of things. If she means like an ambush on cops, I don't know. But if she means like she's shooting and then she does a physical roll, that's a whole other thing. And she was out trying to.
No, she was telling. I don't want to read through all of this, it's just basically she's suggesting she's going to go out blasting.
I gotcha.
I have an explanation for this. Well, not an explanation. I have an observation that I think we as Americans now need to accept. And however,
that 14-year-old is now stable. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, and I'm going to tell you, folks, we have somewhat been here before in this country. And that was the reason for a certain reaction I'm going to share with you. I am hopeful that I will appeal, that this appeal to some officer there, Gulfport PD, Biloxi, Sheriff's Department, or State Troopers, one of y'all, even anonymously, need to show some kind of regret. Now, I'm not talking about crying in your bathroom or over a beer. I'm talking about let we, the American, the Mississippi, the Harrison County taxpayers know that, look, that you're human beings, that you do want to go home to your family like everybody else, and you can certainly appreciate everybody else going home to their families. Little LaMelo ain't going nowhere. He's dead. I want to know why. I want to know that as much as I want to know why Kennedy Hobbs is dead. We've gone past the rule of law, and now we're in the rule of gun. Gun law. I'll explain later. We've been here before. This little 18-year-old girl graduated. She graduated, Bo, and within a few hours, she was dead. Shot down in a gas station. Right there in Jackson. So, she's 18 years old. She gets her diploma. This is a female, you understand. She was shot 3 times. Texaco gas station. She died right there on the scene. The shooter fled, and everyone wants to, be trying to figure who that is.
Yeah, police are still seeking these suspects in Jackson.
You said these suspects. Or are these suspects?
Well, they're being described as suspects, plural.
Really?
Here's our local Jackson News reports.
18-year-old Kennedy Hobbs. She was killed just hours after graduating from Murrah High School. Now we're hearing from family members who held a gathering outside the Jackson Police Department calling for accountability and for everyone to do their part to not let gun violence continue. 12 News, Alex Love was there. He's live outside the station to explain their message. Alex?
Melanie, they all emphasize that the death of Kennedy Hobbs doesn't have to be in vain. Her passing could also be a turning point for all Jacksonians to step up and do their part. They want to make sure that everybody doesn't let other children get caught up in gun violence, no matter where they are or who's at fault.
Kennedy's life and death can be a defining moment in this city.
After spending all night mourning at the Texaco gas station on Medgar Evers, where 18-year-old Kennedy Hobbs was caught in the middle of a gunfight, Napoleon Edwards, her uncle, had this to say.
When we have black-on-black crime at such a high rate, no outcry, silence. Our kids can go 10 minutes up the road to a conservative-based community, not have to worry about weapons, not have to worry about anything. It speaks a lot about leadership.
Several pastors of local churches pointed to so many figures at all levels not doing enough by allowing kids to walk the streets with loaded guns to settle fights.
When it comes to these children, we got to do something. And Everybody, every person, it's time for us to lay down our issues and say, how do we fight for our children?
Kennedy's mother and father were too heartbroken to attend, losing their daughter the same day she became a high school graduate. Activists want their leaders to hear their cries and act.
We're asking the mayor, the police chief who has failed to give us a comprehensive crime plan, to tell us something. We're asking every entity of law enforcement to be a part of this investigation.
Many have been to this Texaco gas station to place balloons at the pump, making a memorial to celebrate Kennedy Hobbs' life. The store also stepped up their surveillance system, adjusting three cameras to monitor the parking lot. Mayoral candidates Charlotte Reeves and Liz Tannehill were also in attendance and gave speeches saying that they plan to help steer Jackson's culture away from gun violence if elected to office. Mayor Shaquan Tarlamumba also sent his condolences to the family earlier in a city press conference. Live in Jackson, Alex Love, 12 News.
Don't sound too excited, Alex. Need to be a little bit more monotone, to be quite frank. I'm be too chipper. The little girl's been killed. We're in the rule of the gun now, folks. I'm going to help you, and hopefully I'm going to help you to save your children and save yourself. There's something I know about this, because it's historically based, folks. We're Wild Wild West now. Cue up Cool Mo' D. We're in it. And we're in it primarily because of conservatives. I mean, and by the way, that handkerchief head who said, well, I can just go up the street there to a conservative neighborhood and my kids are safe. You need to consider what happened in Tallahassee with a 12-year-old and a 14-year-old Caucasian kids shooting at police. Well, I can give you some other instances, too, to be quite frank. You school shootings that the Caucasian kids. So let's not make this racial. It's racial only in as much as, and I cannot deny and won't deny this, is that African Americans' excess in opportunity to kill each other and desire is far greater, so it seems. Opportunity, access, and desire. Now, let me just tell you, ladies and gentlemen, and when you have the rule of the gun as opposed to the rule of the law, it's simple. Gun wins. That's it. I wish I could make it any more clear than that. It's not whether you're doing something right or wrong. It's, okay, I've got the gun, shoot you, I win. This is the environment that we are now placed in, thanks to those individuals who are advocating everybody in this world should have a gun. Texas are now moving in that direction. There are some little cities, and just assume you strap up and have six shooters. I am never, ever, I don't ever feel safe around anybody with a firearm, cop or otherwise. I don't. That's a lethal weapon. That doesn't mean I walk around scared and paranoid. It doesn't mean, okay, I got to respect this. I got to watch this guy. Cops should not feel comfortable with any and everybody having a damn gun. Are y'all crazy?
I'm safer when everyone has one. Let's just everyone get one.
Here you are, a guy who locks up people. You know, not everyone's a convicted felon. Someone has a grudge. The only solution is, I'll kill you first. We've been here before, Dodge City. Or not only Dodge City, the great expansion, the manifest destiny of America for being from sea to shining sea. And this is how the West was won. It was not won with locking arms and singing, we shall overcome. You want the land, you kill for it. Just ask the Navajo. And that's just how it works. And if the buffalo came on your land, kill them too. That's the law of the gun. I mean, it's and ladies and gentlemen, we are here. And we are here because conservatives wanted us to be here. Because of their own fears, their own insecurity. As this nation becomes more, quote-unquote, majority-minority, I gotta have some protection. My strongest weapon is my wit, my mind, folks. But we're in the rule of the gun, and I'm going to share with you, for those of you who are crying about this little tender life loss, Kennedy Hobbs. Controlling the gun is probably almost impossible. Not almost. Controlling the opportunity is almost impossible. The one thing you can do, Mom and Dad, in communities is this. You can get some control over the desire to kill somebody. Someone desired this. Someone made it up in their mind. They were going to kill Kennedy. They were going to kill Kennedy Hobbs. Someone made it up in their mind. I have an idea about this. It's morbid, but it's been tried. And it has been effective. Has been affected. When I come back, I'm going to share it with you. Tragic situation. Horrible situation. How do you stop the desire for another human being or even a child to shoot another child? How do you do that? How do you get them to understand the seriousness of what they're deciding to do before they do it? How do you get them to realize the implications thereof? I mean, they know there's jail, they know there's a crime. How do you put some visual in their mind to say, you know, you need to think about this. Do you really want to do this? We'll be back.
Now existing customers and new customers get our best.